We are at what is known as Point X. Why it's Point X, I don't know, but you are looking now over the plain of the Verve and the St Maur salient. And if you look away in that direction, you will see a big white building. That effectively is Thiaucourt, which is where, beyond that, that's the line of Thiaucourt, which of course is the American cemetery that we went to the other day. Metz is up in that direction, and of course that's where Pershing wanted to get to. But Foch said, no, you know, logistics. And I think you can see the distance. This is a vast distance. And it would have been very difficult to take. And what in fact happened was that the Germans had actually set up a secondary defence line, which is roughly, if you look at the sunlight over there, the dark countryside between us and that, that is roughly where the German second defence line was. So that would have been a much bigger block because the Germans were deliberately retreating from right to left up towards that area. Now, in fact, the Germans get here in September of 1914 and they take the ridge. So they take this ridge, which, as you can see, has a commanding view over the plain and also to the north. So the French are on the right-hand side, the Germans are on the left. And in April of 1915, the French, because they actually do want to pinch out the St Maur salient, they launch an assault up the right-hand side of, well, from my right hand, the northern slope of Les Eparges, and they battle away for 2 months. They're able to get onto the ridge, but they cannot take Point X. The Germans hold this ground, and of course, it gives them this commanding view. This is strategically really important, and it blocks the French from any further advance, because there's no way that they can come down this plain as long as the Germans are holding this ridge. There've been very heavy casualties by the attacking French, and I'll read you a description of what it was like. This is by Hauptmann Mensch. Since the beginning of April, a terrible battle has raged, the intensity of which only the participants will be able to appreciate. The French have already tried unsuccessfully to break through on our left and right flanks. Our division has a difficult position. The fighting is merciless. No quarter is given, and we have taken few prisoners. One enemy attack follows the next, each preceded by a bombardment that does its best to level our positions. Each attack is beaten back, with the French suffering terrible losses. In some areas, our troops have to abandon their positions to escape the artillery, but the French are wrong if they think these positions are taken. Violent counterattacks with the bayonet throw them out of the positions, and our troops have on occasion continued the counterattacks until they broke into the enemy front line, but were forced to abandon the French positions due to heavy enemy artillery fire. The positions have all been flattened, and at night the men work hard to rebuild the earthworks, the pioneers labouring tirelessly. The French have suffered very heavy losses. They throw the bodies out of their positions to form a protective wall. They seem unable to bury them. No man's land is covered with bodies. Our losses are also heavy, but our artillery does excellent work. They fire on the reserves, preventing them from reaching the front line where they would be able to enter the fray. The attacking troops are met with a terrible storm of shot and shell. So the French continue these attacks April through May, and then they decide that what they're going to do is they're going to start mining, and they start digging mines. And over the next 2 years, the Germans dig 46 mines and the French 32 are actually blown. Now, mining becomes a huge part of the conflict in various areas. Some of you may have been to, I know you've been to Vauquois, some of you may have been to the Somme and looked at some of the mines there. The mining was basically, the aim was to, rather as in medieval warfare, when if you were besieging a castle, you would dig under the castle walls, dig a big hole, shore it up with timber, and then light a big fire, and hopefully that when you burnt the timber, the whole wall would come down. And if you think of the Western Front as a wall, you can see how mining comes about. And what you would do is you would try and tunnel underneath your enemy trenches and blow them up. And it became very sophisticated because you would actually have, the enemy would be mining in the opposite direction. You'd have listening posts to see if you could hear where the miners were. And you'd then blow them up. It became quite a bloody form of warfare. Britain excelled in it in the early stages of the war because Norton Griffiths, who was a civil engineer and was digging tunnels under London, went to Kitchener and I'll see if I can actually do it. There's a lovely story about him going into Kitchener's office and explaining who the clay kickers were. And the clay kickers were the miners. And what he did was he got down on the carpet and he said, well, what you do is you have a spade like this and you cut into the face of the tunnel, and that's how you do it. And then you scrape the earth back out again. And he was using Kitchener's coal shovel to do it, because the clay kickers literally lay on their back and shoved the shovel into the face of the tunnel and dug it out, because they were tunneling through clay. And it had a huge advantage because clay is soft and it doesn't make a noise, whereas the Germans were basically hard rock miners. So they always used picks and shovels and they could be heard. So mining becomes a huge part of the industry. In fact, Norton Griffiths actually had miners in work. There's a lovely story about how he came over to France. Kitchener said, go and see what you can do. Comes over to France in his Rolls Royce with a case of whiskey on the back, goes around the various headquarters, says, absolutely fine. Yes, we'd love your guys. He gets his men together and they're miners. These are miners, mark you. And they're put into the army and they're issued with rifles. And the first thing the army does, they say, well, for God's sake, don't give these guys rifles. They don't know what to do with them. So they go off to France and they start tunneling, and it becomes a major part. And in fact, in 1917, the British Army were employing 70,000 men who were doing nothing but tunneling and digging dugouts and things like that. It becomes a huge part of our military effort. In fact, 70,000 people digging holes in the ground in 1917. The British Army today numbers about 75,000 men in total. Gives you an idea of what happens. But this is where the mining here is some of the most intensive mining operations anywhere along the Western Front. As you saw as you came up, you saw all those massive tunnels, craters. And how you would actually create your mine is you'd dig in underneath the enemy lines. When you got there, you would start to dig a chamber to put in explosives. We used explosive packed in biscuit tins, literally in biscuit tins, and you put it in. And as soon as you start packing explosive into that chamber, you prime the mine. You actually put a line, a firing line into it in case the enemy break through, in which case you just destroy it. And the British in the Battle of Messines in 1917, we had 21 mines. And we fired about 17 of them. And those mines there are still active mines on the battlefield of Messines that with explosive in them. One blew up and I think it was 1955. It got struck by lightning.
It was the charge cord got struck by lightning that set off the mine. The ones that are underground now have not got the charge cords in them.
Well, even so, but there are two farmhouses on the near Messines that both are built, because they were strong points, they are both built on top of mines that are still sitting there with all the explosive in them. So interesting house insurance. So that's a very brief sort of look at mining.
What do you do with the dirt when you dig it up?
Good point.
Very good point. You try and hide it as much as possible because it immediately gives away, particularly in the Ypres salient, because the clay they were digging out, when it's exposed to oxygen, turns blue. But the photographs of Les Eparges show both sides made no attempt to, because it's basically it comes out as a white chalky rock. It comes out, it's virtually impossible to disguise, and if you look at an aerial photograph of Les Eparges, it is literally just white piles of dirt coming out. So both sides knew what was happening, and you have the same thing at Vauquois. The spoil heaps, there was, you know, because the mining was taking part on an industrial scale. And I mean, one of the advantages about if you've got a flat mine and a tunnel going down, you can then run a railway away from it. Here, the slopes are too steep, so you couldn't run a railway away. So all you can do is just literally just tip it down the slope and get rid of it that way.